one of those rather marvellous holidays that you can only have if you are still students and if you don't have any caring responsibilities. So we metaphorically threw our watches away and toured the sort of hinterland of, because we were at UEA at the time, went across the country and explored the Welsh border. And it was a very meandering kind of relaxed holiday. And at one point, near Hereford, we saw a sign, a little sign that said Kilpeck Church. And I loved looking at ecclesiastical architecture. I had to go and look around your cathedral tomorrow because I haven't ever seen it. Isn't that where Jane Austen? So we drove up to this little church called Kilpeck. There was nobody around. It was really rather striking and very, very beautiful. It was built in the 12th century by a guy called Hugh of Kilpeck, and he really wanted to show off to his sort of local neighbours. And so he brought in stonemasons from the continent, imported a lot of French stonemasons going to pass out into Spain, for example. And what that meant is that he ended up with a church architecture of Romanesque style that was deeply eclectic. It really is extraordinary. If you do get a chance, go and have a look at it. All sorts of wonderful influences on it. Many of the masons that he brought over were familiar with the pilgrimage routes to Santiago de Compostela, and on those routes they came across all sorts of iconography and images that they wanted to incorporate into their stonemasonry. And one of those is what's known as the corbel table. And this is a fairly unique kind of feature. It's particularly complete here at Kilpeck. And as you can see, it looks like a row almost of gargoyles. I describe it in the book as kind of like a weird sort of bumping. All the way around the church you get these corbels. And some of them are, all of them are different, and some of them are quite self-explanatory. We've probably got a fairly primitive Adam and Eve type figure here, so far, so church. Here we've got a mermaid holding a mirror. That, again, was a familiarly sort of Christian iconography, the idea of vanitas or vanity. Of course, it's a woman's top of the mirror because women are vain. I have no idea what these two are. They're just so desperately cartoonish. And the expression on the dog's face, having been stuck for 800 years next to this rabbit, it just looks so fed up. So we're walking around and we're looking up at all of these individual corbels and trying to sort of decipher them, trying to understand, trying to take photographs. They're quite high up, so they're quite difficult to see. And we were really, really struck. We went round looking at them all, and then we came across this corbel. That's pretty much what we said. We did that thing where you're not quite sure what to say. You look at each other and you think, who's going to be the first person to say what this corbel is on this 12th century Romanesque church? What's she doing there? Well, I found out some years later she's part of the Sheena Magig tradition. There are many Sheena Magig figures on churches. The jury is still out as to why that is. They have various significations and functions. There are many in Ireland particularly. Many of them have been defaced, probably in the 18th and 19th centuries, but Sheena Magig survived. So because we couldn't understand what on earth she was doing, this explicit image of a female figure holding open her vulva, we thought, okay, we're going to have to get to find out what this is about. So we went into the church, and what's rather lovely is because it was such a small church, it had an honesty box next to a little 19th century booklet that a guy called G.R. Lewis had written, which is called A Guide to the Corbels of Kilpeck Church. So we popped our pennies into the box and thought, right, now all will be revealed. We can find out from G.R. Lewis what on earth this figure is doing on this church. So we flipped through the pages of the brochure and we thought, yeah, we're going to get there, and then we got there, and this is what he told us. So our 19th century church cataloguer told us that 26 represents a fool, the cut in his chest, the way to his heart denotes it is always open and all alike. And we looked at each other again and said, that's no cut and that's no chest, and what is going on here? Because when you put them side by side, what really strikes me is how Lewis's figure's hands are pointing away, very pointedly. Now, Lewis spent a huge amount of money to document these baubles. He came over from London, which is a very Welsh, very remote Welsh village. He brought expensive scaffolding so that he could get right up on the level of the baubles. It's a major project and one that he felt very passionately about. And at the core of that project was Lewis's kind of doctrine of honesty, the honesty of the true church as he saw it. And he's just not that honest here. So it really set me to thinking, what on earth is there about what to me is quite explicitly and clearly an image of female genitalia that so troubled Lewis that he compromised the authenticity of his entire project and wanted to silence her by making it into him who's turning his hands outwards. A little caveat here, of course. Not everybody who's a woman has a vagina, and not everybody who has a vagina is a woman. And that's kind of given as far as I'm concerned. It's not given as far as any other feminists are concerned. But that's my stance. So when I talk about vaginas and women, I'm using those in kind of flexible ways. It would be lovely to say, well, that's 19th century propriety, that's okay, surely now we can be more honest. But actually, what I identified in what Lewis was doing was a continuation of a sort of tradition of misogyny and lineage of not being able to talk honestly about women's bodies. And that's a tradition, that idea that you can't look at them, you can't talk about them, you can't have language for them, that continues to today. And I want to kind of trace a little bit of that tradition now. In the 1940s and 50s in America, there was a trend for a practice of douching. Now, in my research and discussions, I found that this is far more an American, North American tradition than it is a British one. And if you're not sure, it means the insertion of the liquid into the vaginal passage, into the canal, to wash out all the nasty, dreadful, terrible stuff that might lurk in there. What they don't realise is that actually it's the most fabulously designed self-cleaning organ. None of that stuff is needed. But if you can't talk honestly about it, and if you can make people so scared about it that the hands go outwards metaphorically rather than inwards, you can make money out of people, because fear means people buy things to stop being so afraid. So a product was released in the 1940s and 50s called Lysol. And I really love this image here. Okay? This is, I never know her name, what would you like to call her?
Ariadne.
Ariadne. That's such a Winchester answer. I was thinking Anne. But yes, Ariadne. And this is Tom. Now, Ariadne's problem is that she is held in a web of indifference, okay? Because we know that all that Ariadne wants is a relationship with Tom, but there's this spider's web in the web. Day after heartbreaking day, I was held in an unyielding web, a web spun by my husband's indifference. I couldn't reach him anymore. Was the fault mine? Well, thinking you know about feminine hygiene, yet trusting to now and then care, can make all the difference in married happiness. As my doctor pointed out, he said never to run such careless risks. Described Lysol brand disinfectant for douching always. But this is clearly a marvellous thing to do, to squirt Lysol into your vagina. Ariadne has found Tom's love and close companionship. friendship once more. Believe me, I now follow to the letter my doctor's advice on feminine hygiene. Always use Lysol for douching. I wouldn't be satisfied now with salt, soda, not with Lysol, a crude germ killer that cleanses so gently yet so thoroughly. It's easy to use too and economical. The very best part is Lysol really works. Lysol has two key active ingredients. The first of these is called cresol. Cresol is a distillate of wood and coal. The second key ingredient is mercury chloride. And as soon as you hear the word mercury, quite rightly, you think, okay, gosh, what's happening here? And there are numerous documented cases of women who overuse Lysol because, I mean, frankly, it has put his newspaper down. There are documented cases of women who used this a lot and caused irreparable damage to their genitalia because of it.